Hello, good afternoon. Welcome to my talk about security automation data. My goal today is to tell you a bit about what is present as security automation data, what kind of formats exist, what the acronyms are that you might be seeing day to day, and also look at how SUSE is using them. For myself, Markus Meissner, you probably know me, work in the product security team here at SUSE as project manager and also distinguished engineer. On an agenda-wise, I will briefly introduce the topic and then go largely by the time of invention or the time of making it present of the automation data, because that seems to make to me the most sense of that. So why do we want it? It's kind of clear why we want it. The amount of computers is growing and growing and growing. I said that 5 years ago, I could have said that 10 years ago already, but this is really an ever-growing amount of things that contain computers. And even in the very smallest private settings, we will these days have a very hard time enumerate everything that has a computer. Yeah? The laptop, obvious. Tablets, phones, obvious. But your TV has a computer. Your car has 10, 20, 30 computers. Your camera, your kids' toys. Not to forget the home automation. So looking at Adrian's home automation setup with like 50 small computers and so on. And of course, in your regular enterprise setting, you have a lot of computers with different types, judging from bare metal, edge devices, virtual machines, containers, or something in a public cloud that is running on a computer you don't own. Interesting of those of that you need to differ what kind of care or how many attention you need to put on those. Yeah? So if you're looking at your home use, your laptop is in your responsibility. But still, if you run Windows, you can just decide apply updates or not apply updates. On Linux, you can be more detailed, more fine-grained, and can even inspect it much more than what you have in Windows. But your TV, you can perhaps update it. Perhaps it does even that automatically, or perhaps it doesn't. So the amount of care that you can put on computers differs. Some of these managed by yourself, but most of those actually managed by other people. And of course, how much relevance is there? So the small embedded chip in a toy is not internet connected. But your camera is Wi-Fi connected. Your phone is really in a big bad internet. Yeah? So that's really the relevance of how to manage this and why to manage this is of importance. The main thing that where we always need to start with is inventory. As I mentioned, you need to know what you have and what you need to know what is on it. And inventory exists at different levels. So hardware, what kind of hardware you have, what operating system is running, what software is installed, how is the software configured, what kind of specific settings are there, and of course, recurs as necessary, like into VMs, into containers, how much nested, whatever that your setup is. Without it, we are really kind of lost. So we need to know what the inventory is. And as we are a software vendor, of course, the operating system and the software installed is the primary thing that we have there. There we have considerations like the life cycle, the effectiveness of security issues, primarily for us from a security team. And looking at the code is recursion for embedded sources. These days, not every package is from one source, but packages can embed multiple sources or are built with multiple static other libraries and so on. So recursion for static builds with the new style compilers like Go or Rust. Always depends on where something was built. So if something was built on /8, it's of course a different thing if it was built on /15 or OpenSUSE Tumbleweed. And in the end, what is more important even these days, how to prove to the outside, how to prove to others that what you deliver as software is correct and was built the way that you said. As mentioned, with the amount of software, with the amount of computers, manual work is nearly impossible there. You need to automate everything. So in the beginning, one of the more formats that came up is coming out of the SCAP family, the secure content automation protocol family that I will looking at first. so defined by the US NIST and largely was invented to provide a formalized and automated way of hardening systems. So I will get to it, how that is happening, just starting from the building blocks. The SCAP is a whole family, so it contains multiple protocols, multiple formats, specifiers, OVAL, XCDF, OSL, RIF, CCE, and so on, and has, of course, SCUNDI in version 1.3, and is supported on the SUSE systems and on the Rational Linux systems by a tool called OpenSCAP that implements the usage of these formats or generates these formats. Starting with the basic thing, one of the basic building blocks, the common vulnerability and exposures identifier. So every security vulnerability has an identifier, a so-called CVE. It doesn't say anything how severe it is or how critical, how widely impacted it is. It's just a dictionary entry used to be as a key. It's handed out by so-called candidate naming authorities. The ID looks CVE, year, and the running number. The running numbers go up to 20, 30,000 these in the recent years. So you have a kind of an impression how many security vulnerabilities get actually identifiers assigned. One of our tasks at SUSE is to track those, and if some are missing, to assign those. If you're a packager, one reminder or one ask is make sure you copy and paste these and not type them manually, because flipping numbers can happen easily. The next building block is the common vulnerability scoring system. So people try to fit something into a framework. So how problematic is the security vulnerability? And of course, people want to have a number. Yeah? And so they invented a scoring system that in the end crunches out a number between 0 and 10. Does not go up to 11, but 0 to 10. currently, it's at revision 3.1. Version 4 is being worked on. So that shows that there is incremental understanding of the whole space, of the whole scoring space. CVSS itself, as it is right now, consists of three potential vectors that are multiplied with each other: base vector, temporal vector, and environmental vector. Base vector belongs only to the software itself, to the source code, and where it is built on. The temporal vector includes things like, is there an exploit known? How reliable is the exploit? And such cases, so to know how well or how good exploitable something is. And the environmental vector is something that is defined on the target machine. So likely, is there some mitigating factor that the software is not set UID root or something that might reduce the impact? Base vector looks like this here. It's classified into various specifiers like access vector, AV, local network, something like that, access complexity, high, or attack complexity, high or low, privileges required, if a user needs to click something, is user interaction required, there's a scope, like does it change between privilege authentication modes, and of course the impact. So there's always the classification between confidentiality, integrity, and availability. So clear from the naming, that can be non, low, or high. And that in the end is put into a formula and then turned into a number between 0 and 10. And is used by various people to classify kind of risk or urgency, how quickly to apply these updates. As we are talking about software, it's of course, understandably not easy to map everything into this kind of fixed scheme. And there's a lot of interpretation, a lot of evaluation from humans necessary, so judgment necessary. So not all scores differ between, scores might differ between different persons rating them or between NVD and SUSE, for instance. CPE, Common Platform Enumeration, mostly for inventory, where you can, how do you specify a software version? And they tried to think of a way to standardize that in a kind of tagged form looking like a URL with vendor, product, version, minor version, subminor version, and so on. So this format is occasionally used, so we use it in our OS releases, we use it in our security data for packages, but it's not really widespread. And these days, people have tried or are trying to replace this with things like PURL, package URL. So, but if you see CPE, it's about common platform enumeration. There's common configuration enumeration, CCE, again, a dictionary referencing configuration entries that's used in, for instance, our hardening automation. Common configuration scoring system, that's also the first time I heard about this when doing this talk, actually. So I've not been very familiar with it, but it measures the severity of configuration mismatches, like that etc. Shadow is world readable is, for instance, much more severe than just having a telnet client installed or similar. So it's used in the hardening tooling to then differentiate with the, on a severity what you need to fix or what you need to fix first in that regard. Part of that is also OCIL, Open Checklist Interactive Language. So one step before automation is with there's a checklist generated and the checklist out of the automation data is the checklist generated and tests and remediations are manual actions. So that is kind of old school. We don't need to specifically use that. And now we go into the funny formats and the big interesting formats. So one of the most expressive one is OVAL, Open Vulnerability Assessment Language. And the goal is to detect things on the system. It uses CVEs, CPEs, CVSS, and so on. And it can detect presence, permission, ownership of files. So it can detect that etc. Shadow does not have permission 640 or is not owned by root user and shadow group, for instance. It can look at the content of files. I'm not sure if it does more than line-based, but I would need to dig into that. But most interesting for us, it can also see RPMs, RPM versions, name, version, release, and can do logic based on top of them. So it can basically express checks like, has this file these permissions or not? For RPMs, do we have the kernel default, 5.4 something installed, or a lower version installed, or a higher version installed? So these kind of checks can be expressed with that. And on top of that, you can have definitions that describe vulnerabilities. So you can say the vulnerability CVE 2022-001, you are affected by that if you have the Ucode Intel package lower than version 22-something installed. So you can put this into the automation, into the OpenSCAP automation. It will report that the definition for CVE 2022-0001 is true if those package conditions, for instance, are not met. So this is something that, for instance, at SUSE we do to provide CVE to RPM mapping. The whole checks that I mentioned, like the file presence, RPM namings, that can be per definition expressed in a tree of criteria that can be combined via OR AND logic. So system is affected when we have a product /15 or product /15 service pack 1 installed and the kernel is less than version 1 or the kernel default devil is less than version 2. Or something like that. Similar for etc. Shadow. So for SUSE, we provide our security vulnerability data in OVAL format. We have it indexed in two kinds. We have it indexed by CVE. So you can really have it, you know, if the CVE affects you or not. But we also have it indexed by our patches and advisories so that you know which actual patch to install. We also include this not just for our released updates, but we also express not affected in this logic. Not affected meaning that we just state version is greater zero or something. So that you can see even if a CVE did not get any security fixes from us, the database uses our internal tracking exported to OVAL and the OVAL says CVE so and so is not affecting your system. We also express the in QA state, might showing red even though you have no possibility to remediate it yet, but yeah, just to expose what we have, also the affected and not affectedness to the outside. Again, the OpenSCAP tool can be used to just evaluate that and go through the report. OVAL is also used for detection logic in the SCAP security guide in the hardening code later on, so in the so-called XCCDF. What is XCCDF? And here we get into more XML trees, more XML funniness, is the extensible configuration and definition format. So the goal is provide flexible security hardening automation defined in a XML language. So what the security technical implementation guide, the hardening guide, have is usually they have a definition, the description, where they describe the problem, they describe how to check for it, they describe how to mitigate it, how to remediate it, and put on some severities, some priorities, some identifiers on it. And that has been turned into this extensible configuration and definition format. and you can express that with that. So there are also some high-level profiles. So if you have multiple hardening means like STIC or so, STIC, HIPAA, PCI DSS or so, then there are specific rules that these enable. So not all of them might want to have Telnet not installed or something like that. So, yeah. We ship this kind of hardening guide built out of an upstream project called Compliance as Code. Our certification team has actually two or three developers actively contributing to that to help with the SUSE work. As XCDF and OVAL are heavily nested XML, as I mentioned, manual editing is close to impossible. You cannot do it, but you usually don't want to. So Red Hat and other people invented a generator framework in a public project called Compliance as Code, where they describe these problems and these rules and remediations in, I think these days, YAML format, and can generate with a generator framework all the necessary security automation data out of that. So we are developing the SUSE profiles. We were responsible for the STIC profiles imported there. We also the PCI DSS, HIPAA, and we also contribute to the CIS profiles. If you're looking at SUSE, LEAP or SLES, it's shipped in a SCAP security guide package. Yeah, as mentioned, we provide for various standards these kind of hardenings. ANSI, not mentioned yet, is a French the French hardening guide effort. And we did something specific for our public cloud images, where our public cloud team basically merged as much as possible from all the existing ones into their public cloud hardening. So looking a bit outside of the SCAP space, the next pieces, specific tailored to security reporting is the Common Vulnerability Reporting Format, CVRF. The goal was originally to provide advisories in a machine-readable format, but it's of course also used for importing into other scanning tooling. For instance, the container scanner Trivi imports our CVRF data and turns that into container scanning metadata. Again, uses CVE, CVSS, CPE identifiers and scoring, and is in a kind of very verbose XML format. Yeah, so it's no logic, so it hasn't really logic, so you really need to list everything in there, which is a bit, makes it a bit quite verbose. For SUSE, we publish CVRF by advisory ID again, so every advisory encoded in this format, and we also post this by CVE. In the by CVE data, we also declare the status of the CVE, if it is fixed, if it is not affected, released, or in GA. So as a vulnerability exchange format. Disadvantage here of that is that every advisory CVRF, every CVE CVRF is one file. So you have directories with thousands of files, which is a bit hard to manage. But the format is not really handling this differently. There's a next generation of that called Common Security Advisory Format. Basically, same concept, same methodology, just JSON instead of XML, so it's a bit less big. and has a bit more refinement on state, status of the products, and also includes the vulnerability exchange profile directly, so the CVE profile. So what we do, again, we publish them by advisory ID, and we also publish, again, indexed by CVE with affected, not affected, released in QA state. Again, disadvantage, lots of files. On our FTP SUSECOM, no longer FTP, but HTTPS website, and you can just mirror them and use them. They are under common Creative Commons license. The last years have seen quite massive changes, additional changes to the landscape. Why? The software is becoming more interlinked. There are more third parties involved. You rarely buy from one vendor, but you buy from multiple vendors. They buy from more vendors that use stuff from third-level vendors, fourth-level, and so on. So attacks are usually not happening against you, but against those suppliers or their suppliers. And we saw several cases, very high profile cases of those. For instance, the SolarWinds attack, everyone probably heard of that, that provides services and software to others. And also, one of the examples is Log4Shell, where it was not clear who else had embedded the Log4j component, Java component in their tooling, because Java is high on embedding, and people did not know where Log4j was embedded everywhere. And also the attacks becoming more impactful. So it's not just a single server exploited, it's usually your whole company gets ransomware, or a big denial of service is run against you. Similar things. So really, there is a monetary impact. So you need to take care about that. So what changed after SolarWinds and Log4j? The governments now see this as their very high priority, and they put out requirements on it that need to be fulfilled. For instance, the US government issued an executive order. And of course, the companies supplying the government jump on that requirement. There are third parties operating on that, and so on. Europe and other countries are working on Cyber Resilience Acts that also try to define that all suppliers, all companies, all critical infrastructure need to handle this cybersecurity in a proven and reliable fashion. What they're covering and what was not really well covered is so-called software bill of materials, so like that you exactly know what is in your product, following the Log4j problem, where you didn't know, do I embed Log4j or not? What they also cover is attestation of provenance of build, so that you can reproduce what the vendor is doing, like that you know that the vendor built the software, not some intermediate exchanged suddenly components of the software. Of course, all with cryptographic assurances, signatures, hashes, and so on. Very big topic out of that, and that has kept us also busy in the last year, is software bill of materials. So a clear inventory of what the software contains that you are delivering. Up to now, you could have just said, I do run RPM minus QA, and you get a list, linear list, on your SUSE system, but of course, you not just have Linux systems, but also Windows systems. And these days, you not just have a linear RPM list, but we also ship containers, we ship public cloud images, and so on. So there's more diversity in the whole delivery ecosystem. And of course, what happens more often, not everything is a one-to-one relationship to a package. So if you're looking at Go packages, there is the primary Go package, but it embeds in a vendor form a lot of other Go components. So the tradition is that it just bundles all the Go modules in its own vendor directory. And you, of course, want to know about that too, looking for security vulnerabilities. And of course, that every of those sources needs to be cryptographically verified so that hashes are provided and can be verified. There are currently three main file formats or identifiers for that. So the SPDX project, some of you might know this from licensing, has a SBOM file format. Cyclone DX has an SBOM file format, and there's also software ID tagging, which I have not looked deeper into it. What SUSE delivers since some months is the format SPDX 2.0, actually preferred by the Linux Foundation efforts, and Cyclone DX. Cyclone DX is a bit more widespread in the whole container ecosystem. They're not very much different, but to support both toolings, the toolings that support either format, we implemented both. So for our ISOs, we deliver both formats for containers. We currently embed the SPDX 2.0 in the Salsa attestation format. Currently missing are the maintenance updates. So for the maintenance updates, we are not yet delivering that. That's an open topic. SPDX 2.0. Originally, SPDX was for license tracking only, but these days it's also for software bill of materials, and they also want to extend that to build provenance and similar things. So we use, it can actually be delivered in multiple file formats with similar syntactic structure, but we use JSON, as this seems to be the most wanted format these days. Similar Cyclone DX, that cannot just cover software, bill of materials, but also hardware, operations, I think even crypto, if not listed here, and similar things. One big topic that is also newly required is vulnerability exploitability exchange. So saying that your components are affected or not affected by something, also declarations of that. There is actually existing formats, but I'm not sure why the standards seem to ignore that. So CVF and CSAF provide some of this functionality already, and we deliver those. but other vendors have also picked up on this topic, like Cyclone DX offers that, and there's actually a new OpenVEX project that the OSS Open Security, Open Source Security Foundation is picking up, is looking at. So basically VEX, exchanging vulnerability effectiveness or not. So this is also out of the new requirements from the governments. There's also vulnerability disclosure report. Not sure how much that differentiates from an advisory notification or that we already also provide. Let's see how much standardization and requirements are put on there. It's a bit more new. Last but not least, coming to the end, is attestation and provenance. With SBOM, we are looking only at software, so the software components, but we are not talking about how it was built and in what environment it was built. And that is now also able to be published in security automation format. So the first that was doing it, or the primary where we were looking at, is the so-called Salsa in toto provenance, where we specifically output a JSON description, where we really link with what RPMs we build something, what sources we used to build, including everything hashed with SHA-2 hashes, and in the end signed signed by our publishing key. The interesting thing is it really links into our sources.suse.com website, where you can even then download all the RPMs that were used for build. And I think Michael Schröder from the build service team actually also built a tool that where you can input this in toto provenance and build again the same RPM out of that. So this is a bit challenging there to provide a tool that can provide a reproducibility of this build. So we provide those for RPMs, we provide those for our ISOs and for our containers. Currently, so you can download .salsa_provenance.json lying beside the RPMs or the attestation tag out of the OCI registry. There are, of course, challenges to this kind of provenance. So think about rolling releases. So how do you go, how do you, you would, to provide the correct provenance, you would really need to provide all temporary build RPMs from the beginning, yeah? From the real beginning of import. So it would, if you would do this for factory, it would just grow and grow and grow. So that's kind of a challenge, and so far, even upstream, a bit unsolved problem. So they are not considering those cases where you really build from the ground up. And of course, bootstrapping, where do you start? Who do you trust first? You can say, yeah, here I take OpenSUSE Leap 15.4 DVD ISO and start from that or something. But how do you trust that this old ISO is okay? Yeah, so where do you start providing provenance? So, and this, yeah, and this concludes my talk. Are there any questions? Over there, Santiago.
Wait a second, because I wrote the question, but I don't know. So, with this salsa in total provenance, there is this part where you are providing SHA hashes for the build configuration, for the sources and the RPMs that are listed. Do you see value at some point to also provide hashes or some sort of evidence of the tests that were run to provide a given maintenance update?
I mean, in general, that would be, so this in total provenance format is kind of open. You can put in more tags. So I think no one really thought about putting QA results into it. So I'm not personally aware of formats that specified it separately, but it could also be included in that, for instance. Yeah. Say, just speak.
So as a follow-up, because coming from certifications like voluntary voting guidelines for the US, one of the things that we had to do during certification of a voting machine was to actually provide evidence of those test results. So that's where the question is coming from. But we can talk about this later.
Yeah. Not really that aware of that yet, but yeah, thanks. Over there? Or,
do we already publish, or do we already have SBOMs for public cloud images?
So I think the public cloud team was working on that to provide it. So I wanted actually to ask Robert Schweikert how far they are, but I know that they've been working on that because our suppliers want that. Yeah.
Okay.
Also the public cloud providers wanted that we published it. Yeah.
Okay.
So we are working on that.
Yeah, I know Robert was working, but don't know the status.
Yeah, but I don't know the exact status right now.
Okay, and second question, what would be the equivalent to RPM minus minus verify in a container?
I mean, usually the containers, if they're uploaded, these container artifacts are SHA-256 protected, and then the container registry, these are signed by the SUSE container key, for instance. So you would rely that the container image as a whole is provided by SUSE by verifying the container signature and then going back to our default signing key. As these packages are coming out of our RPMs, of course you can also cross-check them against our RPMs within the container if you want. But usually the integrity assumption from the containers is that they are signed by container key that is verified by the container runtime and just goes via these SHA-256 hashes over the container images.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
So you're probably already aware of that, but I wanted to highlight that Uni and SUSE Manager then are extracting these OVAL data and processing them to allow checking the status, the security status of the systems that are managed there. It's currently not that easy to do. There's quite some handling, and there is a Google Summer of Code project that has been started. It's about to start next week on making that easier.
So
watch out for changes.
Yeah, thanks. So yeah, we have this OVAL support in SUSE, SUSE Manager for that. Yeah. Okay, if there are no more questions, then thank you. I hope it was informative.